Good morning. Good morning to those of you online. So glad that you're here. Good morning. Also, I'm just going to do a little shout out. Hi, Student Point. Over here, hanging out over here. Good to see you guys this morning. Really glad to be with you. Glad for those of you joining online. I just want to mention as Heather's praying, one of the things that just I was reminded of, that I just want to remind us of, is so much of what we do because we believe people matter to God. And because people matter to God, the one matters to us. And so we've talked about this idea of the one, and this idea that there's probably at least one person in your life, maybe it's a coworker, a family member, a friend, maybe it's the barista at the coffee shop, who God might want to work in and through you, to pray for them, to love them, and to share your story, share about Jesus, share your life with them. Because I'm just reminded again this morning, I just believe people matter. I believe you matter. I believe your story matters. Those of you at home, you matter to God. And so, because people matter to God, the one matters to us. Last week, we started a new series. We called it Triggered, Responding to the Chaos Around Us in Healthy Ways. Now, I don't know about you, but this last week, it's like I had a lot more opportunities, or I was like a lot more aware of the things that triggered me. I don't know if it happened to any of you, but I had lots of moments this week where I'm like, oh man, I got to practice what I preach. What were my points in my sermon again? My kids are like triggering some emotions in me. I'm like, oh man, how should I respond to this in a healthy way? There's a couple times where I even felt like jabbing my wife, which was not a good thing, but like, you know, are you triggered, honey? You know, like, oh, okay, that'll trigger a conflict. Don't do that. That's not a healthy thing to do either. But I don't know about you, but this series is proving to be pretty relevant in my life. So if for nothing else, I guess the preacher is having to preach to himself more, because even as I prepare for this week, I'm like, oh man, I need to live this out. Like, this is getting a little bit close to home. So this term, triggered, it's a psychological term, and it refers to that emotional reaction that people have sometimes that there's often a reminder or connected to previous hurt or trauma. That's sort of the technical meaning of it. But it's become more widely used to sort of refer to anything that just sort of sets people off. So anything that sort of threatens our egos or our pride or our values and disagrees with us, or things that push our buttons, or things that add to our stress, or things that sort of drive us to our addictions, like whatever, like there are a number of things that can sort of trigger us. And the truth is all of us have triggers. You may call it something else. Maybe you call it your pet peeves. Maybe you say something pushes your button. Or maybe it's just personality quirks. But we all have things in our lives that sometimes hit a nerve. Sometimes hit an emotional nerve. And even if you're pretty self-controlled, you're like, look, I don't got any emotional nerves that get pushed. You're really self-controlled and you handle your emotions really well. Life still confronts us with opportunities to make decisions on how we will respond, whether in redemptive, healthy ways or in unhealthy, reactionary, unhealthy ways. So even if you're like, I don't have triggered emotions, life will bring things into our lives, sometimes unwanted, and we have an opportunity to respond. And so we're talking about how do we respond to people. Last week, we talked about how do we respond to people when they push our buttons. And if you missed last week's message, we're on Apple iTunes and on YouTube. You can go back and watch that. Today, we're going to talk about pressure. And then next week, we'll talk about temptation and trials. How do we respond to people, pressure, temptation, and trials? So today, we're going to talk about pressure. Pressure is actually necessary and can be good. Like our bodies, so they don't like explode or something, actually need a certain amount of atmospheric pressure. Our lungs need a precise amount of atmospheric pressure to breathe. Your blood pressure needs to maintain a certain degree of pressure in order for your body to be able to actually pump blood to the extremities of your body. But it needs not be so high that your blood vessels explode. Just a little bit of like biology this week I was reading, and a biology teacher is going to be able to explain the intricacies of this much better to you, but basically I learned that we are a complex pressurized container of fluids and gases. Like we're just this pressurized container of all sorts of things happening. And so pressure can be good. Also in life, we need a certain degree of pressure to sort of motivate us and inspire us and push us to grow and thrive and succeed and excel and do life-giving things. Like, we need a certain degree of pressure. It's good. It motivates us. But the key thing about this is it needs to be sort of the right balance. Like, some of you have maybe experienced, if your blood pressure is not at the right place, if it's too high or too low, your body starts doing some wonky things. If the pressure in our life is out of balance, it sometimes has a way of affecting us. Have you ever felt like the pressure in life is just too much? Like, it's just too much. I know I have. There have been times in my life where I felt like there were just too many plates spinning, too many irons in the fire, just too much going on, and it felt at times like really, I genuinely mean this. It's not just a figure of speech. I felt sometimes like I was in a room, and all four walls of the room were just closing in on me. It was just a matter of time before I would be crushed. According to a recent study, since the outbreak of the pandemic, 75% of people say they feel more socially isolated. 67% of people report higher stress, 57% are feeling greater anxiety, and 53% say they feel more emotionally exhausted. And I want to point out, they're saying higher stress, more emotionally exhausted, greater anxiety. So before the pandemic, there was probably a base level of anxiety and stress and emotional exhaustion. It's not saying they weren't at all before, it's just the pandemic has increased it all the more. I don't know about you, but there have been times the last couple months where it felt like normal everyday stress was just more acute. Like, the pressure, for some reason, I was more aware of it. Some of us, maybe you have work stress. There's deadlines, quotas, performance reviews, and just an endless series of tasks that push you to a breaking point. Maybe you're short-staffed, but the expectation is still to produce the same amount of bricks or more with less straw. Like, you're short-staffed, but the expectations haven't compensated for it. Or maybe you work on commission and sales are low. For some of you, maybe your livelihood feels at stake, and so you're stressed about something that really matters. Like, you've got to provide for your family and for your needs, and so there is this real sense that maybe your livelihood is at stake. But for some of us, sometimes I think it's maybe not so much that our livelihood is at stake. Like, the truth is, we'll be okay, we could budget, and we could live within our means, and we're not really going to lose our job, but what's at stake is our identity. Because for some of us, we go to work, maybe, and it's this drive, this sense that today could be the day that maybe they find out I don't have what it takes. And so, our identity and that nagging question of, am I enough? Do I have what it takes? Well, we have to succeed. We have to excel. We have to meet those numbers because my value is at stake. And so you go to work every day, maybe not even realizing it, but you're going to work with this stress that you have to prove that you're enough. And so every deadline, every quota, every project, so much is at stake. You have to succeed. And so you have this work stress. Or maybe it's not work stress. Maybe there's relational stress. You love your kids, but there's so much sometimes. And maybe you feel like, and maybe it's just me, but maybe you feel like sometimes you oscillate between not disciplining them enough and they're going to grow up and be these rotten hellions, or you're disciplining so much that they're going to need therapy for the rest of their lives. And you just have this tension and pressure about it. Or maybe things aren't bad with your spouse, but you just don't know the last time you guys felt really close. Or maybe there's a relationship with a coworker or a friend, and it started as a discussion, but then it turned into a debate, and then it detonated into a full-blown conflict, and now you carry this angst inside and this stress and pressure because this relationship isn't reconciled, and you once were really good friends, but then you talked about that subject, and it blew up, and now there's just this internal weight of pressure and anxiety about that relationship. Maybe there's health stress. And this one is one of the hardest because it makes you feel so out of control. You've got a negative diagnosis, and you don't know how you're going to be able to walk through this next season. You want to trust God, but you don't even know what it looks like. Or maybe you're walking with someone you love, who they're there. Like, they had a diagnosis, and their health is challenged. And the paradox is, they seem to have great faith, and they're persevering through it, but you're falling apart. Maybe it's just life stress. That stuff that we say is normal, everyday life stress. but it's just all cascaded at once, and it feels like an avalanche of pressure. And I mean, we all know appliances break, right? Like, we know when we buy that washer, it's not going to last forever. But do they have a pact with one another that when one of them goes out, they all go out? Like, is there some secret conspiracy with the appliances in our house? Like, the washer went out, now the transmission in the car is going bad, and now the furnace, it's making a peculiar noise. And so you're bracing yourself for that. And it would almost be funny if not for the bill. Pressure. Pressure that triggers stress and fear and feelings of overwhelm, anxiety, and worry. And maybe sometimes your chest just feels a little tight and you just want to escape and cope. And maybe you do. And maybe you escape and cope in ways that don't look that bad. Like it's just food or Netflix or social media or shopping. And so you can sort of almost have these addictions that are sort of socially acceptable. It's not that bad. Or maybe you cope in ways that you know aren't healthy. Alcohol, pornography, toxic relationships. Or maybe you don't cope that way. Maybe you're just on edge all the time and you are like a powder keg waiting to explode. Is there a better way? Is there a way to walk through the pressure in our lives that is healthy and life-giving and can sustain us? I want to look to the scriptures because I think we will find that there are some things that scripture offers us for how to walk through the pressure in our lives without existing in this sort of constant chaos and turmoil of stress and anxiety and worry. And so I'm going to look at three different passages. They will, they should be on the screen behind me, so you don't have to flip to all of them. You're going to be looking at Matthew 6, 25 through 34, 1 Peter 5, 7, and then Philippians 4, 6 through 8. I'll be reading from the NLT. They should be on the screen behind me, but I'll be looking at, just in case you want to write it down, look at it later, Matthew 6, 25 through 34, 1 Peter 5, 7, and then Philippians 4, 6 through 8. So Matthew, this is Jesus talking. This is usually understood to be part of his Sermon on the Mount. He says, "That is why I tell you not to worry about everyday life. Whether you have enough food and drink or enough clothes to wear, isn't life more than food and your body more than clothing? Look at the birds. They don't plant or harvest or store food in barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them. And aren't you far more valuable to him than they are? Can all your worries add a single moment to your life? And why worry about your clothing? Look at the lilies of the field and how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing, yet Solomon in all his glory was not dressed as beautifully as they are. And if God cares so wonderfully for wildflowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. Why do you have so little faith? So don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat? Or what will we drink? What will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers, but your heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else, and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring its own worries. Today's trouble is enough for today." 1 Peter 5, 7 says, "Give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares about you." And then lastly, Paul's writing to the church at Philippi, and he says, "Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need, and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. This morning I want to talk about how I think if we're going to walk through the pressure in our lives in a healthy way, I believe that we need to sometimes adjust our perspective and implement some practices. So adjust our perspective and implement some practices. I just want to point out the obvious. As Jesus is teaching, he's teaching about worry and anxiety. He says to the people he's teaching, and it's believed that he's probably outside on a hillside somewhere. And so it's very possible that there were actually birds flying and wildflowers in the field. And so he calls them to look at the birds, look at the flowers. And it's just this simple reality that Jesus is calling them to turn their gaze, to shift the perspective, to look at something else for a moment outside of themselves, something outside of the problem. A simple shift in perspective, turning our attention away from our worries. Widen your gaze. Look around you and consider other perspectives. Paul says to fix your thoughts in his passage. At least part of responding to the chaos around us in healthy ways will involve sometimes shifting our perspective or taking off the lens we're looking through and looking through a different lens. And I believe the two things we need to see rightly. One is we need to see God rightly, and then we need to see our pressure rightly. Jesus says, look at the birds. They don't plant or harvest. It's their food and barge. But your Heavenly Father feeds them. And aren't you far more valuable than they are? He goes on to say, look at the lilies of the field and how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing. Yet Solomon, all of his glory, is not dressed as beautifully as they are. Listen, and if God cares so wonderfully for wildflowers that if you're today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. Your Heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Peter says that you can give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares about you. That word all means each, every, any, all, the whole, all things, everything. You can give all of it to God. Paul writes that we can pray about everything. I'm getting the sense from each one of these passages that are talking about worry that there's this overwhelming message that God cares about your day-to-day life. All your cares. Pray about everything. He will certainly care for you. There's this sense that God wants us to know when it comes to our worries that he cares, that he is good, that he loves you, that he is interested in what weighs on your heart. I think sometimes we struggle so much with the pressure of life. Maybe could be because we struggle to believe God's good, that God is there, or that God would concern himself with my stuff, with my stress. Like, would he really concern himself with it? I was talking to a friend earlier this week, and he said something along the lines of, I don't know that most people struggle to believe in the existence of God, but I think people struggle to believe that God is good. Let the words of Jesus sink in. He says, your Father. It's an inherently relational term he uses, and Jesus, I believe, used words on purpose. Your Father knows what you need, and he will certainly care for you. You can pray about everything. Yes, you can pray about that leak and sink. You can pray about the noise your car is making. You can pray about that life-altering decision. Wherever it is on the spectrum, you can pray about everything because he cares about you. If we're going to go through the pressures of life, I believe we need to see God rightly, and we need to see that he is good, that he loves us, that he cares for us. And I want you to understand how actually mind-blowing this is. The creator of the universe, the one in whom all power and majesty resides, the one who time can't even hold, he is infinite and eternal. This God, he cares about you. He cares about your day-to-day stuff. He cares about that thing that's stressing you out. No matter, like I said, if it's a leaky sink or it is a life-altering decision you're going to make, he's intimately interested in what you're walking through. And so if we are ever going to be able to go through life's pressures, I think we need to have a good handle on that. We need to know and believe and have this confident hope, this confident assurance, this confident belief that God certainly cares for you. The other thing we need to see rightly is our pressures. I don't know about you, but a lot of the things that cause stress in my life are aggravated by my runaway imagination. Like, some of the things that cause stress in my life are exasperated and aggravated by my what-if runaway imagination. My stress is infused sometimes with fear that is based on what-if non-realities. So many of our what-ifs are not reality. They are what-ifs, not what-ars. I know that's bad grammar, but my point is we what-if something that is not actually happening at the moment. And I don't know about you also, but a lot of the times some of my worst what-ifs actually never happen. There's maybe a couple times where a what-if plays out. But I would say, I don't know, this is just throwing out a number, but 75-85% of my what-ifs never come into fruition, never come into reality. In his book, Rediscover the Passion, the Promise, and the Power, Pastor Bob Moss writes, when we misuse our imaginations to worry or to be anxious in thinking of all the possible things that can go wrong, it's like experiencing a sense of failure before it happens. I've read that the human psyche isn't able to distinguish between real stress and imagined stress. Both affect us physically the same way. I want you to think about that. Our what-ifs, physically, we experience what-ifs, and our body goes into that sort of flight or fight response. Adrenaline and stress and cortisol and all these hormones are released in response to something that we are imagining and entertaining. Jesus said, these things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers. But your Heavenly Father already knows all your needs, so seek the kingdom of God above else and live righteously, and He will give you everything you need. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring its own worries. Today's trouble is enough for today. Jesus says that our thoughts need to first, we need to put the kingdom of God in its proper place. Our perspective needs to be first on the kingdom of God. But then He also says, Jesus doesn't live in a fairyland. He knows that today has responsibilities and stress and things you have to do. He knows that each day will bring worries. But He says, don't live in tomorrow. Don't imagine the what-ifs of tomorrow. Today, let today take care of itself. Put the kingdom where it needs to be, and then see your pressures rightly. Because here's the thing. Paul says, fix your thoughts. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Because here's why. This is important. What you entertain in your mind will influence the reality you experience, because the reality you experience is felt in your body. Jesus and Paul were on to something that neuroscience and psychology has been studying and has discovered, but they were speaking some truth here. What you experience in your body is shaped by all the hormones and chemicals that fire across the synapses in your brain. I read in one article this week, it said that every thought releases a chemical in your brain. What you entertain, what we allow to dominate our thoughts, affects our lived experience because you feel it in your body. So, quite literally, our thoughts affect our brain chemistry, which then affects our lived experience. So, sometimes we need to step back and we need to get perspective. We need to see God rightly and we need to see our pressures rightly. For me, I know that sometimes in my life, my stress amplifies everything else that pushes my buttons. So I'll just give you an example. This may be a real-life example or not. Names will be hidden to protect the innocent. Actually, it's me. It's my name. So let's say I'm stressed a little bit about message prep 1 week. Like, it just seems like it's not coming together, and there's always a deadline. Like, there's Sunday comes every week. There's always this deadline for message prep, and so I'm stressed about it. And then I go home, and my personality, I kind of like things tidy. I like things to put away, but I have two kids. So there's toys everywhere. I also have a daughter who likes to change dresses 100 times a day. And instead of going home and seeing things, like seeing like, oh, he must have had a really fun day today. Look at that Lego creation my son did. I love his creativity, how that reflects the image of God. And my daughter's dress is all over it. And isn't it beautiful that she reflects the image of God and she loves flowers and beautiful, pretty things, and it's just part of who she is. and doesn't love live here, instead of seeing it that way, when I'm stressed about something, what happens is I come home and every little thing, like the toaster was crooked, everything is amplified and I start to be on edge about nothing being in its place, and I'm not a very fun person to live with because what if I fixed my perspective? I'm allowing stress and all this stuff and my thoughts, what's dominating my thoughts and the hormones and chemicals that are being released that are putting me in this place. And you see, like as I'm saying, when I'm there, it feels real and it feels important. And I'm sure my wife knows I think it's important. But as I say it to you, you can all probably tell that a little perspective might do some good. We need to see God rightly, and we need to see the pressures in our life rightly. And then I think we need to implement some practices. We can practice things that are good and healthy and life-giving. And Paul prescribes a pretty brilliant way to respond to the stress and worry in our lives. He says, don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. So Paul first says we need to practice prayer. Practice prayer. And again, I want to emphasize this. Everything. Cast all your cares. All means all. All of it. Take it to God in prayer. We are invited. God invites us to bring all of it to Him. So you can journal your thoughts, or you can scream out loud in the car, or you can cry as you resonate with the words of David when he writes, hear my prayer, O Lord. Listen to my cries for help. Don't ignore my tears. And I'm going to tell you, I've been in each one of those where my prayers have been written in a journal, where I have, in anger, screamed in my car at God about what was going on, where I have read and found resonance in the Psalms as the cries of my heart were echoed in Scripture. You can pray, and I want to, it's not a formula. It's not something you have to feel good at. You can talk to God. You can write it out. You can scream it out. You can read the Psalms. You can read other prayers. You can take all of it to God because He cares for you. In his book, Prayer, Does It Make a Difference? Philip Yancey writes, prayer and only prayer restores my vision to one that more resembles God. Persistent prayer changes me by helping me see the world and my life through God's eyes. And I love this because I believe prayer changes things. Like, prayer can change outcomes. I believe God responds to prayer. I believe people are healed. I believe God orchestrates circumstances. I believe God protects us from other circumstances. I believe God responds to prayer. But what I've found in my life sometimes is I want to use prayer as a way to manipulate, like to get God to do my bidding and manipulate my circumstances. And so God moves in prayer, but I've found in my life one of the things that God does in prayer more sometimes than change my circumstances is He changes me. That when I come to God in prayer, my perspective is aligned to His. I begin to see things through God's eyes. It's kind of that, this is almost cliche, but when we take problems that seem big to us to an even bigger God, it sort of puts things in perspective. And that sometimes what God is wanting to do in the situation that I want to manipulate and change and be out of or make it go faster, God's actually doing something else. And it's changing me. Prayer is one of the ways that I think God helps us bring alignment to His vision and perspective. Prayer is a practice that helps refocus our perspective, reframe our circumstances, and restore our soul. So Paul says, don't worry about anything, but in everything, pray. But he doesn't just say that. He says we should pray about all of our troubles, but he goes on to say, tell God what you need and thank Him for all He has done. This is one of those places, again, where Paul inserts a little bit of brain science. Research is showing that people who practice intentional gratitude are actually happier, healthier, and more resilient. And the reason this goes back to what I was saying earlier is that gratitude, like all of our thoughts, it releases chemicals in our brain. And when we practice gratitude, it actually releases things in our brain that helps motivate us and helps us feel better. It releases serotonin and dopamine when we intentionally practice gratitude. Neuroscience has discovered that the practice of gratitude, so intentionally counting your blessings and focusing on things to be thankful for, it actually changes the molecular structure of your brain. Pray about everything. And thank Him. And focus, kind of like that illustration of going home and seeing love lives here instead of seeing the mess. Seeing there was fun that was had today instead of there's a mess. Seeing I have a beautiful family and kids who are energetic and full of life instead of seeing the mess. Being thankful will actually change the molecular structure of your brain. It actually transforms things that are happening here, and then that affects your lived experience. Because you're an embodied soul. And when chemicals and hormones start changing, you will feel differently. Gratitude, practicing gratitude, will actually change your experience. And so, practice a gratitude journal. Maybe every night this week, before you go to bed, list 10 things you are thankful for. You may feel like, you know, that's a little much. I don't want to commit to that. Maybe you're a little non-committal and you don't like the journaling thing. Maybe listen to praise music on your way to work. Yeah, listen to your favorite genre of music maybe on the way home, but maybe start your day off with music that is sort of characterized by praise and thanksgiving. Or maybe focus on thanking people in your life, like intentionally telling people in your life, thank you. Maybe even coworkers that, maybe even some you don't like. Thank them for something they did, even if it's something small. Just say, hey, thank you for that. And practice all day, just thank you to this person. Thank you to that person. Or maybe challenge yourself to go a whole day without letting a complaint slip out of your mouth. Just try, you know what, I'm not going to. And man, in the winter, that's hard for me. Like, every day, I'm like, it's cold out. I don't like this. I need to not do that. I need to go a day where I don't say that, right? Find ways maybe to intentionally practice gratitude. There's going to be pressures in our lives. They're going to come. And they will come in different ways. But God's not going to totally insulate us from all of that. And I want you to know, too, I don't believe anything I've shared with you is going to, like, pay for the washer if it went out. Or it's not going to submit that project this week because I gave you a 4-point sermon or whatever. I don't know that it's going to remove it or be a quick fix for some of the pressure you're feeling in your life. But I believe if we see God rightly, that sets us up to approach life with a completely different perspective, to begin believing that God is for you, that God is with you, that God cares about you, that He is good, that He is faithful, and that He is just profoundly interested in the day-to-day stuff on your heart. If you have that perspective, and if you begin trying to practice seeing your pressure rightly, putting it into perspective, putting it into focus, putting it in the proper place, and if you practice prayer, which is probably also best practiced in solitude, and if you practice gratitude, I believe it will equip you to maybe deal with the chaos around you in at least a little healthier way than at least I sometimes do. So this morning, I don't know where you're at, and I don't know which thing maybe stuck out to you, but I want to give you an opportunity to respond. The worship team is going to come, and one of the ways we will respond is through song. And worship music is a beautiful way to respond because there's this power in music, and it's also this, like, declaration and anthem of things that are true. And it's important for us to speak those things. But I also want to invite you, maybe this morning the most appropriate response for you would be maybe these crosses over here. I call it the unburdening station. There are papers there, and maybe there's a pressure that you need to write down and then fold it and symbolically drop it in that box there. And it's sort of a way of acting out this posture of leaving it at the foot of the cross. Maybe there's something you need to go to that station and leave at the foot of the cross. Or maybe the most appropriate would be come to kneel at the altar. There's something about kneeling in that posture of humility that that I think we embody that humility, and it does something to our hearts and puts us in a good place to be able to receive from God. But then there's also the communion tables, and there's liturgy you can lead through there, and maybe just reminding yourself, in the same way that you need food and drink, you need Jesus this week. So when you take the elements, it's you reminding yourself, I need Jesus to sustain me. I don't know where you're at and how best. Maybe it's just saying to yourself, I'm going to do a gratitude journal this week. I'm going to try to start saying thank you more and noticing the pressures and things to complain about less. But I want to invite you to respond and join us as we sing.